I have earned my right to speak my mind, and I'm not going to tolerate what I think is silliness, childishness, and a lot of leftist posturing. I mean, we have to be honest, and I loathe the disingenuousness. They don't want Israel. They think they're being very clever. They call it their three-tier. We want the end of the occupation, we want the right of return, and we want equal rights for Arabs in Israel. And they think they're very clever because they know the result of implementing all three is what? What's the result? You know, and I know, what's the result?
I think we've done.
There's no Israel. And if you don't want the framework, then stop talking about the law. And stop trying to be so clever. Because you're only clever in your cult. The moment you step out, you have to deal with Israeli propaganda. And here, they have a case. They say, no, they're not really talking about rights. They're talking about they want to destroy Israel. And in fact, I think they're right. I think that's true. I'm not going to lie. But this kind of duplicity and disingenuousness, oh, we're agnostic about Israel. No, you're not agnostic. You don't want it. Then just say it. But they know full well, if you say it, you don't have a prayer reaching a broad public. That's where the public is now. I support the BDS, but I said it will never reach a broad public until and unless they're explicit on their goal. And their goal has to include recognition of Israel, or it's a non-starter. It won't reach the public, because the moment you go out there, Israel will start to say, what about us? And they won't recognize our right. And in fact, that's correct. You can't answer the Israelis on that, because they're making a statement that's factually correct. It's not an accident, an unwitting omission, that BDS does not mention Israel. You know that, and I know that. It's not like they're, oh, we forgot to mention it. They won't mention it because they know it will split the movement. Because there's a large segment of the movement, component of the movement, which wants to eliminate Israel. You talk about BDS, they make all these claims about their victories. All their claims about their victories. Well, you know what? You see these 10 fingers? These more than suffice to count all their victories. There are superfluous fingers here to count all their victories. It's a cult where the guru says, we have all these victories, and everyone nods their head, and nobody sits down to do the arithmetic on their own. Yes, it's had some victories, no question about it. But the way people promote it, as if it's proven itself and we're on the edge, you know, on the verge of a victory of some sort, it's just sheer nonsense. It's sheer nonsense. It's a cult. And I personally, I'm tired of it. There's no Israel. That's what it's really about. And you think you're fooling anybody? You think you're so clever that people can't figure that out for themselves? No, they understand the arithmetic perfectly well. Are you going to reach a broad public which is going to hear the Israeli side, they want to destroy us? No, you're not. And frankly, you know what? You shouldn't. You shouldn't reach a broad public because you're dishonest. And I wouldn't trust those people if I had to live in the state. I wouldn't. It's dishonesty.
Meinungsmainstream hier, habe ich zumindest den Eindruck, ist, dass Israel vorgeworfen wird, gegen Völkerrecht zu verstoßen. Die sogenannte Westbank soll völkerrechtswidrig besetzt sein.
Ein totaler Quatsch, den Sie da erzählen. In jedem Krieg gibt es den Zustand, dass die Truppen vorrücken. Das ist nun mal eigentlich ziemlich normal und logisch. Und im Völkerrecht ist auch dieser Zustand, dass die Truppen vorrücken und fremdes Land besetzen, ein Zustand, der also völlig normal ist, kann ich sogar sagen. Das Völkerrecht fängt erst dann an, wenn es regelt, wie der Besatzer sich nun gegenüber der Bevölkerung zu verhalten und zu benehmen hat. Aber eine völkerrechtswidrige Besatzung, das ist ein Widerspruch in sich.
Ja, zumindest wird hier doch immer vermittelt, dass es total völkerrechtswidrig ist, ein durch Krieg erobertes Land mit seiner eigenen Zivilbevölkerung zu besiedeln.
Da sollten Sie sich mal die Genfer Konvention ganz genau angucken. Die sind ja entstanden aus der Erfahrung des Zweiten Weltkriegs, dem, was wir Deutsche gemacht haben. Und wir Deutsche haben im Osten ganze Bevölkerungs- oder Gebiete leergeräumt, verbrannte Erde nannte sich das zum Teil, und dann wurden in diese Gebiete zwangsweise geradezu Deutsche hinein deportiert.
Das war nicht freiwillig.
War nicht freiwillig. Und das ist der feine Unterschied zu dem. Außerdem ist ein Problem, inwieweit eigentlich, also die ganzen Konventionen, die reden davon, dass ein Land, wenn zwei Länder, Staaten Krieg führen, dann findet der Krieg in zwei souveränen Gebieten statt. Das heißt, das Gebiet, wo die Armee vorrückt, gehört auch irgendjemandem. Nur bei der Westbank.
Deutschland, Frankreich.
Ja, sowas. Und in der Westbank, Westjordanland, da hat es ja nie einen Staat gegeben. Das heißt, da ist auch nicht ganz klar, ob überhaupt diese ganzen Konventionen alle greifen, weil Israel kein souveränes Staatsgebiet von einem anderen Land erobert hat, mit Ausnahme der Golanhöhen Syriens und des Sinai Ägyptens. Da sind die staatsrechtlichen Fragen sehr viel klarer, aber nicht bei den sogenannten Palästinensergebieten Westbank und Gaza.
Often on the news, we hear the terms occupied territories, 67 borders, and illegal settlements. And the story we usually hear sounds very simple. During the Six-Day War, Israel captured the West Bank from the Palestinians, refused the United Nations demand to retreat, and illegally built settlements. But is that really the case? Let's try to understand the situation a little bit better. We'll start with a simple but extremely important question. From whom did Israel capture the West Bank? From the Palestinians? No. In 1967, there was no Arab nation or state by the name of Palestine. Actually, was there ever? Israel took over the West Bank from Jordan in an act of self-defense, after Jordan joined a war launched by Egypt and Syria to destroy Israel. Oh, by the way, destroying countries is rather illegal. The United Nations back in 1967 rejected repeated Arab and Soviet attempts to declare Israel as the aggressor. Security Council Resolution 242 did not demand a unilateral Israeli withdrawal. Rather, the United Nations called for negotiating a solution which would leave Israel with secure and recognized boundaries. In effect, defensible borders. But wait a second. What was Jordan doing in the West Bank in the first place? What was its legal justification? Well, Jordan had the, you know what? It had no legal justification. Jordan simply occupied it during its previous attempt to destroy the newly established state of Israel in 1948, changing the commonly accepted name Judea and Samaria to the West Bank. But that did not really convince anybody. And almost no one recognized the legality of Jordan's occupation, not even any of the other Arab states. So, if Jordan had no legal claim to the land, and a Palestine did not exist, whose territory is it? Let's go a little further back in time. Don't worry, not to the days of the Bible, only about 100 years. Until 1917, the Ottoman Empire occupied the whole region. After losing in World War I, the Ottomans relinquished their 500-year control to the Allied forces, which decided to divide the old empire into countries. Britain's foreign minister, Lord Balfour, recognized the Jewish people's historical right to their homeland, a small area equivalent to about 0.5% of the Middle East was designated for this purpose. Britain received a mandate from the League of Nations to promote the establishment of a Jewish homeland. But wait a second, do you realize what happened? The Jewish homeland originally included not only the West Bank, but also the East Bank of the Jordan River. I guess you cannot say the Jewish people have not accepted some painful compromises already. Anyway, the League of Nations recognition of a Jewish homeland, which includes the West Bank, was reaffirmed by the United Nations after the Second World War. With the British mandate ending, United Nations General Assembly Resolution 181 recommended the establishment of two states, one Jewish and one Arab. The Jews accepted it and went on to create the State of Israel, while the Arabs refused the compromise and launched a war to destroy the newly established Jewish state. Resolution 181, a non-binding recommendation in the first place, remained with no legal standing. At the end of the war, a ceasefire line was formed, where the Israeli and Arab forces stopped fighting. At the insistence of the Arab leaders, this line was defined as having no political significance. So, although this line is commonly referred to as the 1967 border, it is not from 1967, and it was never an international border. This is why a more exact legal definition for the West Bank, according to international law, is really the same as in so many other areas where there are or were territorial disputes, but which are not defined as occupied. For example, Zubara, the Tamz Islands, the Western Sahara, amongst many others. They're not considered occupied territories, but rather disputed territories. So, let's return for a moment to our illustration and examine the complete chain of events. Israel's presence in the West Bank is the result of a war of self-defense. The West Bank should not be considered occupied because there was no previous legal sovereign in the area. And therefore, the real definition should be disputed territory. The 1947 partition plan has no current legal standing, while Israel's claim to the land was clearly recognized by the international community during the 20th century. That is why the presence and construction of Israeli settlements in the West Bank should not be considered illegal. These are not just my own opinions. They are based on conclusions made by world-renowned jurists, like Professor Eugene Rostow, Justice Arthur Goldberg, and Stephen Schwebel, who headed the International Court of Justice. So what's the solution for the dispute over the West Bank? Unfortunately, there is no magic solution. But the only way a solution will ever be reached is if we base our negotiations on legal and historical facts. So please, let's stop using the terms occupied territories and 67 borders. They're simply not politically correct.